morning and thank you for the invitation and congratulations to the organizers. As it is only natural, I don't belong to the military. I will stress political aspects of strategic analysis and highlight some, of course, aspects of military strategy which are related to this. My intervention, therefore, shall highlight some aspects of political strategy and connect the classical tenets regarding war and strategy with power and the purposes of states and alliances. At all levels, we face dilemmas as regards morality, morality politically defined, and the military approaches that could fulfill national and alliance purposes. What are the dialectics and basic equations of power, politics, morality, and purposes? In the first place, we could remember Clausewitz's commonly accepted tenet, war is the continuation of strategy of politics by other means. That is, war, in all its versions, is guided and limited by the political purposes of civilized nations. At issue, therefore, as regards war and strategy of states and alliances, is politics. Who defines purposes and in what political instances? What is the underpinning political morality? At both levels, domestically at the level of the international system, politics is all about power and the hierarchy of the distribution functions of power. Kenneth Walsh, to me, number one of contemporary theory of international relations, is clear on that. Power is the single most important factor, coin, he said, you know, of international politics. In alliance politics, or in the cases of collective security in the context of the United Nations, properly speaking, the purpose should be the maintenance of international order and the safeguard of international peace and security. Let's remind some of Article 5, Chapter 1 of the United Nations. It's clear and straight. Nothing contained in the present chapter shall authorize the United Nations to intervene in matters which are essentially within domestic jurisdiction of any state or shall require states to submit such matters to settlement under the chapter. It goes on, of course, in Chapter 7 then, and refers to the role and functions of the Security Council of the United Nations if and when there are threats to peace, to international security, even when, of course, the permanent members of the Security Council agree on common action. The United Nations and other related institutions play a coordinating role in the sense that states involved in conflict dispose and by all means, very important, precious mean, a framework in which they meet and debate. Let us focus then our attention on power as the principal factor of international politics. In a conflictual world, military power proper is certainly of utmost importance for the fulfillment of states and alliances politics purposes. What are these interests at the regional level? You couldn't answer it in some words. Nonetheless, a quarter of a century after the end of the Cold War, it is fully confirmed what many of us were saying early in the 1990s, that by demolishing state structure of unstable regional states is politically and strategically irrational. As things evolve, our attention here then are power factors related to regional conflicts and the prerequisites of political and strategic rationality. The danger of escalation of a regional conflict to a global conflict is thus a major strategic issue. Add to these factors logistics in the broader sense, cyberware and certainly bases and supply stations in adjacent friendly and or allied states. Air power and naval power are important inputs in many respects and relate to threats and costs against adversaries, as well as to the transport of troops, and in ways that it creates an appropriate prerequisite for effective operation system. Some additional factors make air power increasingly indispensable. First, as the precision of strikes becomes more accurate, owing to technological advances in aeroplanes and missile technology, air power is more and more important. An integrated force and command structure is indispensable. We stress, therefore, the need for integrated force and command structures. Second, air dominance over an enemy's territory, cutting off its supplies lines, and transport of elite troops in special operations provides space and facilitates other operations of land forces on the ground. General air staff, moreover, is the main source of intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance. An effective communication system, air system, in combination with naval and land forces, is a prerequisite of effective conquer and control of territory. Because, as we all know, at issue in the end, in military terms, but also in political terms, is conquer of territory and control of territory. In fact, integrating force transport land, air, and navy strikes can force advancement, consolidation of land control, and fulfillment of military objectives behind enemy lines, and by all means, a principal purpose for all modern armies. In a forum of high military officials, I need no stress that what everybody knows, that is the fact that land forces, naval forces, and air forces are part of one and the same structure, combining capabilities in order to fulfill common objectives. At issue, therefore, is not the hierarchy of importance of these weapons, of these force structures, but the way of flexible and effective combination in accordance to the conflict in front of us. Naval and much more air power are also related to distance, a fact that necessitates effective combination of their operation with land forces in advance of the fight to conquer and control territory. Bases and supply stations near to potential targets are vital and lead to more effectiveness and less cost. The definition of power in both national and alliance instances should distinguish between potential and actual power. Material and other variables that determine real power are innumerable, their combination infinite, and optimum capabilities an endless political, institutional, and military exercise. In regional conflicts, of the four principal types of power, nuclear, sea power, air power, and land power is both costly and indispensable. Costly not only in material terms, but also in political terms. The case of Somalia, for some, the lesson of Somalia in the early 1990s, demonstrated that modern communications could multiply domestic political costs owing to the casualties. In the cases of Iraq, Afghanistan, and Syria, we witness the fact that the anthropological complexity on the ground could prove costly and sometimes prohibitive. Projecting land power, conquering land, and controlling territory, infrastructure, and resources in conflictual regions is by all means a costly and dangerous balancing act. This is an additional fact that creates the need for effective integration of plans and decisions regarding the combination of land, air, and naval power. At any moment, and in each phase, the precise combination is the work of the joint staff which decides on the precise mixture of force structures in general, specific circumstances, of a constantly fluctuating strategic setup at the level of the regions and the planet that constantly change the single most important factor in international politics, that is, the distribution of power among all the actors involved. An appropriate observation as regards costs and benefits in conflicts of the modern time is the fact that, as it is apparent today, military interventions in the 1990s accentuated well-known divisions and animosities, resulting to the collapse of some regional states. It also gave rise to many unexpected and politically irrational conflicts that changed the map of the interstate structure as we knew it during the 20th century. By all means, and regarding all thinkable political purposes, including state survival, it is questionable as to whether interstate house serves any political or purpose of any state or alliance, and very much related to military plans and decisions. Even if the forces on the ground are a decisive military instrument, friendly and stable states could provide conditions which make easier the combination of air, land, and naval power and create the conditions of conflict resolution in ways that establish rational interstate conditions. And the anthropological complexities, which in the Middle East is a standard fact of life for centuries, if not for millennia. A state or an alliance of states could not possibly achieve political purposes by creating an interstate and interstate mess and then attempt to fulfill objectives by posing costs through airstrikes alone or by fighting lengthy wars of attrition, which experience shows that are rarely, if never, effective. This is the reason that, as already hinted, one could reasonably question the wisdom and the logic behind the scope and results of many interventions during the last two decades. The result was the proliferation of independent transnational actors, including terrorists of all kinds. As we said, the war is the continuation of politics by other means. That is, it belongs and obeys to the logic of state purposes. The restoration, therefore, of viable and stable states in many regions, and of course we all have in mind now the state system from Morocco to Caucasus, is the most important political purpose I can see at this juncture. Chaos is not a political option, and the world, including the regional, at the regional level, without states means chaos. State is rationality. No state is chaos. That's a statement I could make. A world empire is absolutely impossible. A world state is not feasible. We lack. We don't have a world society. Similarly, a government of the governments is as remote as ever, and the multipolar world is already a fact. More and more we have a multipolar world, a complex multipolar world. At issue, therefore, is balance. During the difficult decades ahead, the precious and crucial phrase is balance and political and strategic rationality, which I stress ending that is the state system as the states themselves decided after the Second World War when they signed the United Nations and its constitutional charter. Thank you very much.